Hello, hi all, hope you are doing well. It's the first time here in DevOps event. I'm very happy to be here. I'm Maria Mylona. I'm a solution architect working for CodeHub. Currently I'm working in banking sector. I'm doing microservices in cloud, which is fancy, and I'm very glad about that. Today I came here to talk to you about stability and adaptability, two sides of the same coin. So let's go quickly to some terminology. What is stability? Stability is the ability of the system to stay up and running regardless of the failures happening, ensuring that the user can still get work done. Someone would ask, for how long? I would say, as long as you don't deploy anything into production. If I'm going to put some code, some change code, it doesn't matter if my previous one is able to run reliably for years. What is exactly that needs to keep going? Okay, it is the process transactions. The process transactions are the resonator of our systems, is the reason of our systems exists. We do want to get input from the users, input from the other systems, update our internal view model, and communicate to the other systems. System might be a single application or a network of applications and servers. That makes absolutely sense. When we are talking about stability, we need to define the system that this capability is valid. later on we will see patterns when we are going to see how to not propagate the failure in the other systems or to make some trade-offs, for example, to have a key list and decide which systems should be up and running and which systems should be killed in order to avoid an outage, let's say. Adaptability. Adaptability is the time. It is time. It's time to take, that it takes from observation to action, from the aha moment to actually put something in production and get money from that. Here in the picture, you will see the continuous improvement cycle. Someone needs to sense that we need to do something. We need a feature for some business. Someone needs to state exactly what needs to be done. Someone needs to act upon that, to develop the thing. And later on, we are checking, we get feedback, we see where we are, how did the plan works, what are the next steps. So, adaptability depends on process and organization, system architecture, not only system, information architecture as well. Let's see a simplified view. Initially, someone might say that stability and adaptability seem contradictory capabilities because stability hates changes, as puts the system at risk, while adaptability engages change as it adds a competitive advantage, especially for the time-sensitive market. Stability, back in days, was a responsibility of ops, now SRE teams. Adaptability, on the other hand, is the holy grail for the development and agile teams. Is still this the case? Today, we have the DevOps team. This filled the gap between developers and operation. Let me state here the quote of Sir Jackie Stewart, who was a racing driver in Formula, and he said once, "You don't have to be an engineer to be a racing driver, but you do have to have mechanical sympathy." Mechanical sympathy is a term that we use in information technology, especially for developers. Developers in general are thinking in models, in abstractions. But in the end of the day, you need to have knowledge, you need to have some notion or some sympathy, let's say, for the underlying system, for the operating system, even for the hardware, because you need to know what are the implications of the software that we put in the hardware, security-wise, performance-wise. Okay, let's see, let's agree that not every piece of software needs to change daily. This should be a strategic decision. This depends on the domain. For example, healthcare systems, they have a very costly quality assurance control and all this stuff. So it's not feasible always this high rate of releases. Perhaps if they have something to innovate in some area. So rapid change comes with a cost. And adaptation. When the overhead to cut a release is less than what we get as a return, then deserves the effort. Let's see the patterns that we use for stability and adaptability, and by that, we will see the convergence of the two notions. Timeouts. However, we love integration points because we don't do job on our own, business on our own. We need to communicate with the outer world. Integration points can harm our stability. Why? Because we keep resources waiting, and this is very bad because we don't do actually business. Connection timeouts, request timeouts, even checkout timeouts when you are checking out a thread from the thread pool. This should be established. Circuit breaker is another pattern. Actually, you are going to do this, this pattern is to stop propagation of failure to the other systems. You do consecutive calls to the outbound system. If you don't get a response, you open the circuit, you isolate the thing. Obviously, you have an impact in the response. It's not accurate, but you stop the propagation of failure to the caller of you. Okay. Most of the times, it's better to fail, to stop, to not get the response rather than to wait. Bulk hands is the notion of the SIP, similar one. In the application, it is the application partitioning on sharding based on functionality. So you have different shards with different capacity each one, and that makes you to isolate the impact of a failure. If, for example, one maxes out, your other critical functionality remains untouched. Okay, restrict the load. It is very important to have bounded thread pools. To do proper capacity planning. Okay, we cannot scale out indefinitely, even if we had the capacity of the whole Google. Scale out doesn't mean that you can bring as much nodes as you can send VMs and pods. It is about how your algorithm, your software, is able to parallelize things. Okay, use rate limiters. Rate limiters is not only for the API gateway, is internal for your APIs as well. Test harness, obviously you don't want to find out all these issues in production. You want a restricted environment where you can apply chaos engineering, performance tests, in order to be able to see all these things. What do you want to see? You want to see your single point of failures. You want to see your load patterns, your seasonality. You want to see the specifications of your capacity in each area. Observability, resource governance, these are practices, well-established practices that we need to apply in order to do a proper root cause analysis. And we want all of them to combine in order to have an answer. We want the application logs. We want the distributed traces. We want the average performance metrics. Let it crash. This is the Erlang philosophy. Erlang is very famous, like it's used to telephony networks, and it's famous for the reliability concerns that addresses. Reactive way of programming, Actors framework came from that. Essentially, you have the agent that is processing the thing. If something goes bad, restarts on its own. Okay, we can magnitude that to the cluster level in Kubernetes. Does the same thing, checks the health and readiness probes, if it's okay, routes the traffic, if it's not, does some action, restart or whatever. System architecture, adapt to the new way. Have you ever think of changing your source of truth to not be the old one relational database model? Have all the events, all the DML that is coming to database replicated in an event source, and from that, recalculate this and create some materialized views in order to support your read model. By that, you have a different read model and a different write model, and that is very good for your stability because avoids contention point when you have everything in the same model. Immutable entities, that was the CQRS pattern, okay? Immutable entities, that's another practice, very useful. You have Perhaps you need to also explore a bit the functional paradigm compared to the object-oriented for immutable thing. The pure functions, where you have one input, and by that one input, always you're going to get the same output. This is the holy grail for testing. By pure functions, you avoid state, and this is very good for scale out your system. Microservices, domain-driven technology, is another aspect that we will discuss later on. Adapt to denormalize information. That is information that has a redundancy in the row, and it's not the normalized way where you need to do all your joins to get the response, and you have to support to enforce these foreign constraints, which comes with an overhead. And don't forget that indexes in relational database, B3s actually, are scaled very bad. Adaptability patterns. This is about a team structure, agile technologies, lean frameworks, remove the delay from the act portion of the decision loop, DevOps, SRE, platform engineers, have a holistic view of the development and release cycle. These teams can scale up autonomously. Painless releases, we decrease the effort for a production release. The thing now with the CI/CD pipeline is more automated and standardized. We reduce the impact of the production by specific deployment patterns, as is canary deployment, where you restrict your feature in specific segment of customer, and when it is okay, you sign it off, you put it in the whole audience. Blue-green deployments, where you have production to different environments where you can switch on. Obviously, state here is a pain thing, but you need to be defensive. System architecture, small units of technology and business capabilities, they can succeed or fail their own. They have their own CI/CD cycle. I'm talking about microservices here. They provide incremental changes in the most efficient way. We get feedback, we adjust the functionality. And this is coming not to eliminate complexity. Complexity exists, it's there. It is coming to, and it is a matter of maintainability. You maintain, your repo code is more maintainable. You get your thing, your changes, vertically, front-end, business, service layer, persistent layer. Everything is on a domain context. Everybody is aligned. Everybody is one team. System design. We love the loose coupled event-driven architecture, choreography compared to orchestration, which comes in one place and very quickly can become complex. Apply domain-driven design methodology and the hexagonal architecture as a pattern. Hexagonal architecture is this. In the center, you have your domain, your business logic, your use case. Should be a screaming architecture, should scream its intent, should be straightforward in our code, where is our domain. This is similar pattern with ports and adapter. We have the input there and the output. The input may come from controllers, subscribers, that are implementing a specific interface. Outbound adapters goes to adapter, the concrete implementation, and obviously exposed with an interface. Design for the future. Give some love to change. As we said, the domain is the first candidate that is about to change. We need to also to programming our cross-cutting concerns, which are details, actually. There is the architecture in cross-cutting concerns, not in the domain. We need to apply the dependency inversion pattern, which is actually I'm programming against interfaces, not concrete classes. That can happen to satisfy the cross-domains, cross-cutting concerns, either on application level, but on infrastructure level as well, with a sidecar pattern. Essentially, you have your application, your business, one process. Side by that, you have another process, which is the sidecar, and works for some cross-cutting concerns, that is, monitoring, security, outbound adapters, authentication, authorization as well. Truly, We are talking about the same coin. Stability and adaptability are sides of the same coin, that is business value. Stability engages change by making releases costless and hurtless. Stability embraces evolutionary architecture and can afford changes. Systems adapt to evolutionary architecture. Evolutionary architecture, we say, the architecture that accepts changes and adjusts to that, and become more resilient. Development, testing, releasing, monitoring activities are driven by autonomous agile teams in business as usual, and this is a competitive advantage. The mindset changes. Efficiency is not about fully utilized people or nor about systems with a lot of capabilities. Efficiency is about the rate of the work, the relevant rate of the work that comes into production. It is about supporting the business need at any given time. And as Mark Twain once said, continuous improvement, this delta of improvements, is better than delayed perfection. Because eventually, when comes perfection, everything around you might change. And this is not relevant anymore. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.